Can we get started?
Yeah, I think we can start. There's 5 minutes, it is 4 or 5.
Good afternoon, all. Thanks for joining us. We also have this program streamed in YouTube. I welcome you all. Today we have with us Professor Vidya Sagar, FRS. He's a well-known name, not only at IIT Hyderabad, but in the whole of India. He is a distinguished professor at IIT Hyderabad. He is also the lead team member of Sutra Model. And today he kindly agreed for clarifying all the queries that we have on this Omicron thing that is spreading across India. Without much ado, I request Professor Vidya Sagar to introduce the topic and have our questions clarified.
Yeah, thank you very much. And I am very happy to address the IIT Hyderabad community. I was thinking about whether I should prepare a presentation or not, and finally I decided I didn't want to, because the situation is changing very quickly, and I also don't know what exactly are the concerns on the minds of various people. So if I make a very long presentation, it's possible that I'm talking orthogonally to the things that are on people's minds. So I thought I'll make just a few general remarks, and then you can feel free to follow up on whatever topic interests you. So the coronavirus, which is official name is SARS-CoV-2, it burst upon the world about 2 years ago, January of 2020. And in India, we started seeing cases around March. So we went into a lockdown towards the end of March 2020. And then that particular wave took about 20 weeks to peak. Somewhere in the middle of September, we peaked at about 97,000 cases. So let's call it 1 lakh in round numbers. And then the curve was completely symmetric. It took about 20 weeks also to come down. And then round about late January, early February, we in the Sutra team, which was modeling the pandemic, we noticed that the number of cases was not coming down as we expected. That okay, I mean, the number of cases at that point was 10,000. So we thought, let's not get overly excited about whether it is 10,000 or 8,000. And we noticed that not only was it not coming down as expected, it actually began to climb up towards the beginning of February. Again, not by very much, by a few hundred a day. So we kind of knew that something strange was going on, but we didn't know what. And now we know post facto that what was happening was the onset of the Delta variant, which hit us roughly around that time. Now, if you remember what the situation was like back then, we started vaccinating the... Somebody already has some question? Okay, anyway. Arvind, you can use your judgment on whether you want to interrupt me or not. I don't mind one way or the other.
No, sir. Please go ahead.
You can read the questions, and if you have to interrupt me, please feel free. So anyway, what happened in January 2021, to be very precise, January 16, 2021, we started vaccinating the so-called frontline workers, starting with the healthcare workers, then the police, journalists, people like that. And on March 1st, the vaccination was open to the general public. So first group was the senior citizens like me, and then 45 and above, and then finally 18 and above. So the point to remember is that when the Delta variant hit India, right around March 1st of 2021, we were essentially a vaccine naive population. Other than this very small number of frontline workers, nobody had any vaccine. So you can imagine this very deadly combination, the Delta variant, which was more infectious than its predecessor, and a totally unvaccinated population. So it just went through like a wildfire. And so whereas the peak in the first wave was about 1,97,000 to be precise. In the second wave, the number just kept climbing higher and higher and higher, and we didn't really quite know what was happening. And paradoxically, what the Sutra model showed is that we could predict the time of the peak fairly accurately, but not the value of the peak. Finally, towards the end of April, the model parameters in Sutra had stabilized sufficiently that we predicted that the peak would come in about a week to 10 days' time. And the peak would be approximately 4 lakhs, 7-day moving average. Now, at that point in time, that was a very brave prediction because everybody was thinking that this number of cases would just keep going up and up and up. That didn't happen. And we were off by about 3 days in calling the peak, and we were pretty much spot on target in terms of the actual value. And then by the end of June, July, the second wave had also ebbed. It hung on for a while because both Maharashtra and Kerala were showing huge numbers of cases. The rest of India had gone into double digits or triple digits. But by the early part of this year, the number of cases was under 10,000. I should not say early part of this year, I mean late part of November of last year, early December, number of cases was well below 10,000. Then, so that was fine. Now, I would like to remind the audience that on November 26th, a lady called Angelique Coetzee from South Africa, she holds an important post in the Public Health Administration. I'm not sure exactly what her title is. I should have looked it up. I apologize. Anyway, she announced to the world that the South African scientists had identified a new virus variant, which they didn't call, they just gave it some number. And it would seem to be spreading much faster than the Delta variant. So then subsequently, the WHO called this the Omicron variant. So if you look at the history of South Africa, what happened is that from about November 26th, when this lady, Dr. Coetzee, made her announcement, till December 15th, which is when the pandemic peaked, just 3 weeks. Remember, November 26th to December 15th. In those 3 weeks, the number of daily cases in South Africa went up by a factor of 100. It went from about 250 cases a day to 25,000 cases per day. It was virtually a vertical climb. Nobody had ever seen anything like it. But what was very striking in the South African case was the number of hospitalizations and the number of deaths went up by only by a factor of 8. So while the cases went up by 100, deaths and hospitalizations went up by a factor of 8. Only by a factor of 8. So clearly they were not commensurate with the number of cases. So this led the scientific community and the medical community to believe that this may be a rapidly spreading but mild variant. Then when this variant, by the time this variant was announced, it had already escaped South Africa. So initially people tried a few silly things like bans on international flights and all that. But pretty quickly they realized that this was pointless. I mean, the time for that was long gone. So, and today practically every country has the Omicron variant. And the countries of Europe, like UK, Germany, France, and USA, were seeing massive numbers of cases. USA a few days back had 6 lakhs cases per day. And if you remember that the UK, the USA is 1/4 of our population, 6 lakhs is a huge number. And the UK, which is 1/20th of India's population, they had 1.5 lakh cases per day. So then the question again arose, is it possible that the Omicron variant is not so mild as people think it is? We should be a lot more scared than we are. Now, we in the Sutra team, which is Professor Manindra Agarwal of IIT Kanpur, Dr. Anurag Agarwal, who is the director of IGIB, CSIR lab, Lieutenant General Madhuri Kanitkar, who actually gave an extramural lecture at IIT Hyderabad some time back. And she is also an adjunct faculty in the biomedical engineering department. So she retired from the army, is now the vice chancellor of Maharashtra University of Health Sciences. And the fifth person in the consortium is Dr. Pramod Garg, who is the director of what is called THSTI. Now, if you go to this website called covid19tracker.in, it's actually an IIT Hyderabad maintained website, thanks to Professor Murthy for underwriting the cost of doing this website. There is a link to the Sutra Consortium. So now, we had been asked off and on by various people in the government, primarily the chairman of the Empowered Group, Dr. Vinod Paul, who is also a member of the NITI Aayog, but he was asking us more in his capacity as the chairman of the Empowered Group. What do you people foresee? Should we be worried? So, if you want to gauge the impact of Omicron on India, just remember there are three parameters that you need to study, only three. Number one is, how much faster does Omicron spread compared to Delta? Now, if you see the pronouncements being made by various medical experts, they're throwing out all kinds of numbers, 4 times faster, 5 times faster. And let me assure you, no virus can spread 4 times faster than another virus. If you thought that the South African climb was vertical, if another virus spreads 5 times faster than Delta, these numbers would just be completely off the chart. So those numbers are wrong. We knew that. But we wanted to get an accurate estimate. Number two parameter is, what is the impact of the Omicron variant on vaccination? That is, if you have previously been vaccinated, what is the likelihood that the Omicron variant will bypass that protection? Now, there's lots of papers in the literature on how much protection vaccination gives you. I prefer to use a paper from THSTI, which is the place where Dr. Pramod Garg is the director. And they did a very careful study with only Covishield because they did not have enough Covaxin volunteers. Approximately 2,500 people with vaccines and about 2,000 people without vaccines. And what they showed is that the risk of testing positive, which is called reinfection, goes down by about 63%. That means a vaccinated person is only 37% as likely to test positive. But the risk of serious infection, that means landing up in the hospital, is reduced by 82%. And the most interesting one is the death figures. Out of the 2,500 people, one person died. Now, if you try to apply statistics, and we are a quantitative group here in IIT Hyderabad, you just look at the statistic, you say one could easily have been 0, and one could easily have been 2. Because those are such small numbers when you begin with 2,400 people, that the estimate of the rate of death basically is meaningless. So whenever I talk about this paper, I say the estimate of the rate of death is not conclusive, but it is really, really low. You think about the fact that out of 2,400 volunteers, only one died vaccinated. Okay, that's good news. But unfortunately, our analysis of South African data, we initially started with a very pessimistic estimate that it was bypassing 50% of the vaccine protection. And that did not fit the South African data at all. Then we decided to increase it to 75%. It was still not fitting. So we thought, let's be extremely pessimistic and make it 100% bypass, meaning whether you are vaccinated or not, Omicron bypasses totally. Now, interestingly, there is a study that is going to come out in a day or two. This I can tell you, obviously I cannot show you any slide, which seems to show that in an Indian population, and these are Petri dish experiments. These are not human studies like the one I told you earlier. What they do is they take the serum from vaccinated people, zap it with the Omicron virus and see what happens, right? Does it proliferate or it doesn't proliferate? it's a proxy for what happens in a human being. Anyway, that shows that it seems like about 90% of the people's vaccination protection is bypassed. So that's the situation with vaccinated people. The other interesting question is, what if you have natural immunity? One of the things about India is that about 75% or more of Indians have been exposed to the Delta variant, including children. What happened was that in the early part of the pandemic, the various studies on the presence of antibodies were not including children. They were only doing adults. But in July, August of last year, for the first time, the ICMR studied prevalence of antibodies in children, and they found that essentially they had the same level of antibodies as adults. So this reinforces what many people expected, namely that children are catching COVID to just about the same rate as adults, but they don't get any symptoms. So they're not at risk. So that was the reason for limiting vaccination to people 18 and above. Now, with the onset of Omicron, the government decided to lower the age from 18 to 15. And simultaneously, Covaxin, which, as we all know, is made here in Hyderabad, was approved for children above the age of 12. So we're in a very dichotomous situation. Covaxin is approved for children above the age of 12. But if you go to the Covin portal, you cannot register unless you're over 15. So one of these days, they'll make up their minds on that. I would just like to point out, there is something called the Expert Committee Group of the Drug Control General of India. They recommended Covaxin as being safe for children about 2. Okay. So eventually, that will come. Okay. Now, the third point is natural immunity. As I was mentioning, it looks as if somewhere around 50% of the natural immunity is also bypassed by Omicron. So, you know, I sort of go on TV because of this study, and somebody asked me, what if you have 100% vaccine bypass, 100% natural immunity bypass? I said, then you have a fresh vaccine, a fresh virus. I mean, it's like a fresh pandemic, because nothing that has happened before is going to give you an indication of what's going to happen now. You understand my point? Your vaccines don't help, your previous antibodies don't help, then it basically you're back to square one, right? But we don't feel things are that pessimistic. We feel about somewhere around half of the people will retain their natural immunity. Okay, now we have approximately 5 days data in India. If you look at that 5 days data in India, the time to double for the cases is somewhere around 2.5 days. That means in every 2.5 days, the number of cases is doubling. Obviously, time to double cannot be a fraction. So a better way of thinking of it is in a 5 day period, it goes up by a factor of 4, doubles twice. But what is very striking are two very important statistics, primarily out of Mumbai, which is showing the highest number of cases, but to some extent in Delhi also. Out of all the people who are being admitted, the fraction of people who need hospitalization is about 7%, 7, 1 in 14 approximately. Compared to the first wave, it was 15% to 20%. So the Omicron people are requiring admission to hospital for lower rate. More interesting, you look at the population of the people who were admitted to the hospital. No, we can think of conditional probability. We're all engineers here, so you won't run away if I use a phrase like that, right? So if you look at the people who are in the hospital, what fraction of them required supplementary oxygen? Again, in the first wave, that figure was around 15% again. That means out of the people who tested positive, only 15% needed a hospital. And out of that 15%, another 15%, meaning 2.25% of the original only needed oxygen. But in the case of Omicron, based on 5 days history in Mumbai, out of the 7% who were admitted to the hospital, only 1% needed oxygen. So this suggests that what the South Africans have observed, namely that it is going to be very quickly spreading disease, but with very little by way of consequences. It's going to be mostly mild symptoms. Unless you have some other comorbidities, you should not suffer any discomfort. And now there's a third theory going around, which is that if you have Omicron, then you should be better protected from future variants. This cannot be confirmed, obviously, because we don't know what the future variants are going to come. But for purely virological reasons, people are saying that because of the rapid spread of Omicron, because of the number of mutations it has, it will induce a lot of protection against future variants. So I'll now stop with about 2-3 sentences. We will come out with our new projections. They're going to be very high. They'll be much higher than the 4 lakhs of the second wave. Don't panic. Remember that a very small fraction of those only require hospitalization. Now, you may say, what was the hospitalization rate in the second wave? In large cities like Bombay and Delhi, it was basically 100%. I mean, everybody was running to the hospital because they ran out of beds. And you ask the question, what fraction of those who were hospitalized required oxygen? Again, 100%, because they had run out of space. So if you didn't need oxygen, they told you to go home, you know? So that was not at all a good indicator of the severity of the pandemic. So if you have 8 lakhs cases per day, for the sake of argument, but only about 7%, 8% require hospitalization, and within that only a small number require supplementary oxygen and things like that, what will happen is that most people will be told to isolate themselves at home, watch for symptoms, you know, check your oxygen meter, and so long as that is doing fine, don't panic. Okay. Now, so that is as far as the nation is concerned. I think the reason why Professor Murthy asked me to give this open workshop, open house, is what are the implications for IIT Hyderabad? Because we just reopened yesterday. And quite frankly, I don't know what the implications are, and I'm quite happy to interact with people. You see, in a certain sense, if people are going to get infected anyway, I don't see a big difficulty about conducting classes. It doesn't mean people should be cavalier and say, well, I'm going to get infected anyway, so I don't need masks, I don't need anything. No, it doesn't mean that. You still have to follow the COVID-appropriate behavior, protect yourself. But given that you are following COVID-appropriate behavior, I do believe in-person classes can continue, because the downside of online classes, we all know, we have been professors, so we know that online is not a substitute for the real thing. So is the risk of online classes very, in-person classes very high? I do not believe so. And the comment I would make to Professor Murthigaru especially is, sir, please don't panic with the number of cases. That doesn't mean anything. What you should pay attention to is how many people are hospitalized. If people are just sitting in their rooms, and you know, we may have to have some sort of a hybrid system where for this isolation period where they are tested positive but showing no symptoms, let them stay in their hostel room. Once that incubation period is over, the quarantine is over, let them come back to class. And the interesting point is, for the first wave and the second wave, the government of India recommended the quarantine period as 10 days. Now, the Center for Disease Control in the USA has just reduced the quarantine period from 10 days to 5 days for American healthcare workers. Now, you can think of it in two ways. One is they're making a virtue out of necessity, meaning if every time a healthcare worker tests positive, you put them out of action for 10 days, pretty soon there'll be nobody left. So maybe they're deciding to shorten the quarantine period just simply as a matter of practicality. But I think, to my mind, that's a somewhat cynical view. The fact of the matter is, I think this is a milder disease. Therefore, it is okay for people to come back to circulation after 5 days. And if you don't feel comfortable about 5 days, make it 7 days. It doesn't really matter. So I think what we should do, and this is where I think the community as a whole has to come to a consensus, obviously, let the in-person classes continue. Let us test with reasonable regularity, because people are not going to have symptoms. So let's remember that. And then if somebody tests positive, tell them to isolate themselves in their hospital room for, let us say, 5 to 7 days. Have daily telechats with some doctor. Are you feeling fine? Are you feeling okay? Okay, good. And then once they survive that period, not survive, wrong choice of words. Once they finish that period, they can come back into circulation. But I think we should avoid knee-jerk reactions like, cutting down the institute or going back to online. And the reason why I requested Murthigar is the following. We can bet that media will say 3 days after IIT Hyderabad opened, the number of cases was X, whatever X is. That's kind of meaningless. I mean, X is going to be some very large number, but it doesn't mean anything if all these people are just isolating themselves and are feeling fine and they're re-entering after a week's time. I think that's actually good, because having got the mild exposure for a week's time, they're going to be immune at least for the duration of this wave. In other words, just to re-emphasize, if you've got Omicron and you go through this isolation period, you may or may not be immune from future variants, but you're certainly immune to a reinfection by the Omicron. So you can come back to full participation in campus life without serious worries. So I will stop there. I wanted to be brief. I see I've been talking for half an hour already. So maybe, Professor Rangan, you can start asking me questions also.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for alleviating majority of our fears. As you rightly pointed out, majority of the questions that I've got in my chat box are related to IIT Hyderabad.
Yeah, well, that's fine. That's why we are here.
Yeah, so I will slightly modify the questions. They are a little longer. So one question is what do you think about the number of cases that we can expect at IIT Hyderabad? We have a population of around 2,800. In the oncoming days, how many cases do you expect for IIT Hyderabad?
So you see, the number of cases...
Let me correct this number. Right now, we have 1,700 students on the campus. Okay. We expect this number to go up, but we'll have to see whether they will go up now or not. Now that the classes have already started, okay, if they have not come on the first day, maybe they want to watch and come after 1 week or something like that. We do not know. Every day I'm getting my updates. As on yesterday night, it is 1,700.
But once we count the faculty, we will be close to 2,000 as a community.
So once we add faculty and the staff, which is come approximately 500 or so, it will cross 2,000.
Okay, so low 2,000. You see, the number of daily cases on a population of 2,000 will typically be of the order of 15, 20. That's like 1% approximately per day. Okay. And please don't forget that if today you have, let's say, 15 people diagnosed, they are sent into isolation, then it's like it's like the area under the curve phenomena, that people are also going to be coming out of quarantine. So you have to look at not just the total number of cases, which will be quite high, but the number of active cases. Because when you start counting only total cases, the problem is that is a monotonically increasing number. There is no way for somebody to come out of that list. But if you keep track of the number of active cases, how many people are in quarantine at a given point in time, that will be a much more accurate picture. So I think I would be very, very surprised if the number of active cases ever exceeds 100. And to me, that is already a fairly pessimistic number. Okay, so at any given time, you may be having about 100 people who are in quarantine. I do not expect serious hospitalization unless someone has some comorbidities like diabetes or obesity or something like that. And given that the student population is overwhelmingly very young people, they should not be suffering any adverse effects from this pandemic.
Okay, the other question is, how much percentage of cases actually require testing? In the sense, we confirm that it is going to be COVID only when we go for RT-PCR testing. But we generally don't advise immediate testing when somebody has a fever. What is the percentage that actually requires RT-PCR testing? That is the question one of the person has asked.
See, that's a very good question, and it's not clear how to answer that, because what is the purpose of testing? The purpose of testing is, number one, you want to know you are sick and therefore you need some medical treatment. And number two, you want to know you are sick so that you don't contaminate or infect others. Now, what happens with a virus that bypasses vaccination and bypasses immunity very much is that you yourself remain capable of infecting others for a very short period of time, as it turns out. So what I would suggest for a campus like ours is some sort of a spot testing. You know, every day we just pick some 15, 20 students at random. I can sit with some of the more quantitatively minded people and work out this number of samples that we require. And instead of RT-PCR, we could also try the rapid antigen tests. And those are a little bit cheaper, but more importantly than that, they're faster. You get the answer more or less right away. And then what that would give you is what fraction of the people can be expected to be sick at any given point in time. Now, that is not necessarily the correct question that a person wants. Person wants to know, am I sick? But the administrators want to know, what are the numbers? Are they getting out of control or not? So I think we need this kind of a dual strategy. Sampling to estimate the sick population at any given point in time. And individual students can be encouraged, I would say, at their own initiative to test themselves. Okay. One caution I would make is, don't test unnecessarily. Because I think the testing itself induces a lot of anxiety. So be a little bit conservative. And if our sampling program is sufficiently thorough that everybody will be tested, let's say, over once a month or something like that, which basically just means you're testing 5% of the people on a given day, something like that, that should give, I think, confidence to people. But I mean, I think it's a kind of a good problem. I do know some of the other IITs have started thinking about this whole question of testing design as a problem of sampling. And I can work with somebody and come out with a good strategy. It won't take more than a couple of days. That's what I feel we should be doing. But can I ask a question out of ignorance? How easy is it for people living on campus to get an RT-PCR?
No problem, sir. We have tied up with a few people. Okay. Uh-huh. Our hostel office has a tie up. Anytime they want to get it done, I think within one hour or 2 hours, somebody comes and does
it. Take the swab. So my suggestion is, if you feel some symptoms, please get the RT-PCR. That is at the student's own initiative. Otherwise, I think what should happen is the institute at its own initiative should do some random sampling. And if the people test negative, well and good. If they test positive, go into isolation for 5 days. That, I think, is the way we should do it.
One of the students has asked, we call it as a mild variant, by why?
I can barely hear you. Maybe can you crank up your mic a little bit?
Yes, sir. Just a minute. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, a little bit better. Yeah, tell me, one of the students said?
She has asked, we call it as a mild variant, but why it is so infectious?
No, it's not a mild variant. I mean, the variant is not characterized as mild or hard. It's the symptoms caused by the variant are mild. Because the hospitalization rates are so much lower than with the Delta, and the death rates are also so much lower than with the Delta. That is what has been observed.
Okay, sir. Another student has asked, what if faculty taking a subject need to go on isolation class
What
instead to
is,
be
sorry,
secure?
what is?
No, no, that is not relevant. I'll skip that question. Suddenly, all of a sudden, many questions have popped up. So the people were waiting for you to complete your introduction.
Yeah, I know. I took longer than I intended to, but anyway.
Yes, sir. Professor Bhuvan has asked, yes, sir.
There's a question about large classes.
Large traffic?
Large number of students sitting in a class, single class.
No, no, you have to maintain the you know, six foot distance and all that. If that is not entirely possible, maybe you can give them the option of they can attend the classes every other day or something, and you know.
That's exactly what I told to some of the faculty, wherever the class size is large.
You know, they can watch one, see the class is meeting twice a week. One day they watch from their hostel room remotely, and one day they come to class. I think one has to be imaginative in these kinds of situations. Certainly people jostling around is to be avoided. I mean, I don't think it's necessarily, I think we should avoid it to the extent possible.
Okay, sir. What is the effect of Omicron on less than 3 years old, that is on infants globally?
See, even the Delta, which had a much higher death rate, if you look at the United States, which as on today had over 8 lakhs deaths, 850,000 deaths to be precise, the number of children defined as under 18, remember, is less than 100, less than 1,000. So they contracted, but they don't seem to have any symptoms. And they're at very, very little risk of death. Okay. Now, it doesn't mean no child has ever died. Of course, you can't make a statement like that. But when you see that the US, which has got, I mean, it's climbing close to 1 million deaths, and the number of deaths of children, we were less than 1,000, so that is 0.1% of the deaths only are of children, who make up about 20% of the demographic in the United States. It's very clear that they are not affected very much by this. And in India, the numbers are very similar. We hardly ever hear about children dying during the second wave. And the third wave, again, should be very, very benign towards children. The biggest problem with children is that they get infected and they pass it on to their parents or their grandparents, not that they themselves get adversely affected.
Thank you, sir. Some of the questions, I'm not sure whether it is addressed to Professor Vidyasagar or to Professor Murthy. What are the possibilities of hybrid?
Let's only take those questions which are, you know, which Professor Vidyasagar can answer. Okay, the rest of them we can answer later. Somebody asked about hybrid mode. Okay,
yes.
So maybe I can answer it later. Let Professor Vidyasagar's question be taken.
Yes, sir. Yes. Is it advisable to conduct a random testing on students who come from various parts of India?
No, it doesn't make any difference, because you see, by the time they're mixed into the population of the IIT campus, where they came from becomes irrelevant after about 2 weeks. I mean, you can think about random testing before they let them onto campus, but now I think if you want an ongoing program of testing, I think that you just think of the student body as one homogeneous group, and then you have to design the sampling strategy accordingly. And you see, it's an easier problem than sampling in a village, for example. See, in a village, you have big spread of age groups, big spread of economic status, big spread of living conditions. We don't have any of that on an IIT campus. People are all going to be in a certain age bracket. People all have reasonably comparable living quarters. So I think you can just simply choose them at random, and that will be a perfectly good indicator of the prevalence of disease.
Okay, Okay, sir. There is a question, something like a cost-benefit analysis. What is important, health or study? I would say both are important. Yeah, I leave it to you. The question asked is whether to get infected and attend offline class or attend online class and affect your offline classroom teaching. I think you have answered.
You can get infected anywhere. I mean, you can get infected just walking on the street. So I think that ultimately these are all trying to reduce the probability. Nothing is a guarantee here.
There was a question asked on the Sutra model, but you said that the Sutra model that is there is outdated and tomorrow or so you will be...
No, I didn't say the Sutra model is outdated. I said the projections are outdated.
Okay.
Because the assumptions on which the model was run are outdated.
Okay, sir.
Because we are jacking up the immunity escape to 100% and we're jacking up the natural immunity escape to 50%.
When can we expect the updated projections to be
Should
up
have
and online?
Tomorrow. I mean, I have it in my computer, but we haven't shown it to the government yet. So I feel a bit uneasy sharing it with the IIT community before I show it to the government. It is not proper protocol. We all understand the importance of doing things properly. I mean, especially if we're going to put this on YouTube, I think we should really follow the proper procedure.
Sure, sir. How many such waves can we expect before the COVID gets completely eradicated?
Well, okay, so there are two parts to that question. Let me say COVID will never be eradicated. And the reason for that is very simple. And the virologists have a very simple explanation for this. And it's very natural. Where does the coronavirus come from? It actually comes from bats and pangolins and these kinds of animals that are cave dwellers. The only types of viruses and bacteria that can be eradicated are those that do not have an animal host, like smallpox, for example. If you get rid of smallpox from humans, it has nowhere else to go. Now, if we somehow miraculously make sure that not a single human being has the coronavirus, it just retreats into bats or pangolins, and at an appropriate time it comes back again. So this is what people mean by saying this is going to be an endemic disease. It's always going to be at some low level, and it, because of some circumstances, it suddenly flares up and then goes down again. And that's what we should expect to see going forward. So it should be more like a controlled endemic disease rather than an eradicated disease. Okay, so the answer to the question as asked is never, but that's not a very good answer. So let's just say that how many more waves can be expected before corona becomes an endemic disease, not eradicated? So that is what I was mentioning in my opening remarks. Some people feel that the Omicron, because it is so rapidly spreading, should give us protection against future variants. Whether that is wishful thinking or it actually happens, we do not. But there is some good biology behind that kind of statement. You know, people are I'm not competent to comment on that. But the people who are saying it are not, they are not fakes. They are solid scientists.
Thank you, sir. I'm done with my questions in my chat box. I request Raghu to copy the questions that we have got in YouTube link, if at all we have any.
Raghu, are you there? Hello, Raghu. Yeah, I think some things are coming up.
Many are suggestions, sir. They are not questions.
Hmm.
Well, there's one question I'm seeing in the chat. If even for small symptoms like mild fever, cold, cough, it is necessary to advise the student to get RT-PCR test done. Well, I mean, it's not necessary to get the test done for mild symptoms. You can, precautionarily isolate yourself. What is the ideal number of isolation bed required for IITHC? That's what I was mentioning. If you don't have serious symptoms, you can isolate yourself in your hostel room, basically. The number of hostel beds will be quite a bit smaller because the hospitalization rates are so small, 7%, as I mentioned. That is 7% of the number of cases, not the number of students. So I think we should not be overwhelmed, I feel. But possibly the administration can have some kind of a standby tie-up with a nearby hospital in case it becomes necessary. It should not, but better to plan now than struggle at the last minute to find the extra hospital bed. YouTube Q&A. Can there be a facility for providing the booster on campus? Now, you people don't need boosters. Forget about that. I mean, see, this booster has become a kind of a, how shall I call it? It has become a fashion statement. I don't think it's really necessary at all. And look, Israel and Germany are on their fourth dose, two original doses and two boosters. It's not done them any good at all. So I think it's far better to just allow your body to build up the immunity. If you had two doses, stick with that for now. Maybe, especially for, see, young people would only become eligible in May. So even if you took Covaxin, which has a very short gap between the two doses, you would have had your second dose sometime in June, July. It's only 6 months ago. I don't think you need boosters just yet. And if your first dose was Covishield, then you would have had your second dose in August, September. So you definitely don't need a booster.
There is another question. Is there any paper published related to the long-term impact?
Any paper published on the long-term impact of Omicron? I mean, Omicron is 5 weeks old. How can anybody publish a paper on the long-term impact? See, many people have died due to cardiac arrest after suffering and getting a recovery from Delta. See, this is what happens when people try to extrapolate experience from one country to another country. You know, in the United States, the comorbidity level is very high. First of all, it's an older population. Secondly, people are much more overweight in the United States compared to here. I was reading that 30% of the people are obese, and I said, well, okay, 30% is not so bad. Then I found the definition of obesity is 30 pounds higher than the desirable weight.
In fact, I have read that 30% of the people in services, defense services, are obese.
In the US or in India?
In the US, in the US.
Yeah. it is quite possible. I mean, somehow the Indian lifestyle, much more outdoors and much more incidental walking and incidental exercises, tends to keep us fit, I think. So all these things like cardiac arrest and all that are really a result of comorbidity and the differing age profile of the Americans. We haven't seen that much of that in India. So, but definitely all the young people on campus, you have this beautiful wide area, so walk around, get plenty of exercise, wear a mask, of course, while you do that, and you won't have to worry about any of these things.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. I think that is it. I request the director to conclude the session.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Vidyasagar.
My pleasure.
You are very, very, very valuable 1 hour with all of us. I'm sure some clarity emerged out of this discussion. Of course, as Professor pointed out, that this is something which has just started. So as a result, predictions based on that are not going to be easier with such a small samples that are available. But I'm sure that if we take proper precautions, things will be much better off. So I request all of you to take necessary precautions. And then we have a good campus, utilize this campus being there, for whatever purpose for which you have come to the campus, utilize for that purpose. And if we take ourselves reasonably good care, I'm sure that things will be much better. And he has already given indications that the need for hospitalization is going to be minimal. And that is what I have also been, whenever I was talking to various doctors, is what they say. That is one of the reasons why we thought enough of online classes. And that is how we have started this. We'll try to see if there is a possibility. Some people are asking about high degree. IT Hyderabad, all classrooms are not enabled for hybrid. We have only five classrooms with 25 lakhs funding that has come from our DOD chairman, which we have made, which are all ready now. I think yesterday also some of the faculty members took classes using the hybrid classrooms. So we do not have all the classrooms which can be converted into each room to convert it into a hybrid classroom costs at least around 7 to 8 lakhs. So it's not an easy task to convert all the ITH classrooms into hybrid classrooms. One day possibly we'll be able to do it if we have good funding from somewhere or the other. At the moment, what I have been telling the faculty members is whenever there are large number of students in the class, we can ensure that one day, one batch of students, some batch attends, another day, another batch attends. This way, ensure, and anyway, the teachers are giving you all the notes so that you will be able to. And the fact that you are on the campus, you should utilize that to meet the teachers once in a while, okay, and then get your doubts clarified. And that's one of the main reasons why we brought all of you onto the campus. And we also ensure that all the faculty also come to the campus so that they are available for you. Okay? So not only for you, our campus is such a thing that it does not have all the faculty staying on the campus. Please understand this. We have only 50% of our faculty stay on the campus. The remaining 50 stay outside the campus. They are all coming only for you so that they can provide you the necessary knowledge base that for which you have come to the campus. So I think we will do our best, both in terms of academics, how whatever we can do, and also in terms of the healthcare that is needed. So do not get unnecessarily, worried, and then just disproportionately, magnify, your imaginations. So try to keep your cool. And whatever is needed, we will do our best. And this is going to be a dynamic process. Yeah. So looking at the situation daily, we will try to discuss with the key team. And then if any decisions need to be taken, we will take it and we will come out. I think that's the only way out right now. There's no point in simply deciding that we will stop offline classes and go to online classes. And that is not, and there are quite a number of, while you have examples of some IITs going for online classes, you also have examples of some IITs doing offline classes. In fact, there are some IITs which have brought even first year students back into the campus, knowing pretty well that they have not even taken even one vaccine. So at least we said let all the students have double vaccinated so that at least their possibility of, as Professor Vidyasagar also pointed out, that the possibility of getting affected is much smaller once you are vaccinated twice. So that is the strategy that we have taken. Every IIT has their own strategy. The only commonality between IITs is only JEE. Other than that, there is nothing common between IITs. So each of them, we were possibly one of the first to send all the students back, by 19th of March 2020, when most of the other IITs have not even started thinking about it. So, and similarly, we were possibly the first to bring back the students. August 2020, we started bringing back. We brought even the health workers first, quarantined them, fed them for about 15 days, and then gave them accommodation on the campus, and then ensured that when the students come, they are all there. So we do our best. Absolutely. We are all here for you. I think students should not think that we are here to impose certain things on you. It's all being done for your own good. I mean, no IIT student should complete their degree without seeing the IIT. So that is not a way to learn. It's not a way to learn. For example, if M.Tech students do not come, 2020 batch would go without seeing the gates of the IIT, without even spending time with their colleagues, contemporaries, and with faculty. And there is so much of inspiration that you get when you meet the faculty and then discuss with them. So all these things are essential part of learning, and we strongly believe that these are important as a part of learning. So with that, I think, thank you very much, Professor Vidyasagar Garu.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us. Thank you.